Once we finish making our graph, what we want to be able to do is describe it. Describe the shape, describe the trends, and describe any unusual features that are coming through. So what we'll do with these cases is kind of think about the type of histogram that would be made for each of these cases. So what we're going to talk about first is shape. And actually with these, we're going to be using a unimodal graph, which means there's a single peak to it. So there's going to be this one peak, which we'll talk about mode in that next piece down there. If the graph is symmetric, what it should look like if it's a histogram, if you graph it, it should look like you could fold it in half and it should roughly land on top of itself. So something like this. It doesn't have to be perfectly symmetric, but just roughly symmetric where it looks fairly even on either side. Then these next two shapes, they're skewed left and skewed right, and the direction is very important as well. If the graph is skewed left, what it will look like is the bulk of the information will actually be on this right-hand side, and then there will be this kind of trail of data to the left. So what's happening here is that most of the data is on this higher end of the number line. However, we have some extreme small values, and it's where those extreme small values are that are important to our data, because it's those values that are going to be skewing things opposed to what usually happens, which is happening in this area over here on the right-hand side. So there's a few very small values, and that's why it's skewed left, is it wants to know where's that tail, where this tail is on this left-hand side, and that's important. Skewed right looks pretty similar, but it switches. It's that most of the data is out at this lower range, so we have almost something that's symmetric, but then it just kind of trails off on the right-hand side. So there's these few extreme, in this case, large values that are coming through. So it's like if we were looking at values of homes in a neighborhood, it would be that most homes would land at this kind of lower range, but then maybe there are these few really large mansions that have higher prices to them. And it's those few large values that don't make up most of our information, but they're important because they're skewing our results. Now, it's very common to mix up these two directions here because a general feeling can be that if it's skewed to the left, you'd imagine most of your data to be about on the left-hand side. However, that's not what the skew is asking us. Whenever we're asking about skew, think about where is the tail. Where is the tail for the data? Because it's where the tail is that the important information is. We're getting these extreme small values or extreme large values that are skewing our results. Now, in terms of mode, mode describes highest frequency. In terms of a graph, that's going to come through as a peak in the graph. So it's going to be this high point of the graph. If we have no mode, that's going to be a uniform distribution. So it should look something like this, basically roughly even like that, where you're just getting the same frequency across the number line as you collect your data. Unimodal would be a single peak, and that's actually what we've drawn up here above. So symmetric, this left skewed and right skewed, those are all examples of unimodal graphs because they have a single peak. And bimodal is going to look like where we have our graph. It raises up to a peak, decreases out, and then rises to another peak and decreases out. The peaks don't have to be the same height, but there should be this kind of movement of increase up to it, decrease out, and then start increasing again and decreasing out again. It's like a roller coaster. If it has this kind of smooth increasing and decreasing, then it creates multiple modes. Multimodal is just where you have more than one of them. So you could have a peak here and then decrease out, something there, and then something there. So 3, 4, 5 beaks, and that would make it multimodal. Now we want to be careful of bimodal and multimodal, because what they do is they suggest subgroups. What it tells us is that there's probably some subgrouping in our data, and it would be better to actually separate the data. So for example, say we were looking at fiber content in bread. So we go to a grocery store, we take a sample of 100 loaves of bread, collect their different fiber contents across different brands, and we make a graph. What we might see is something maybe either bimodal or multimodal when we do that. And why that is because some bread is high fiber, some bread is low fiber. So it might be something like we'd see wheat would group up higher on the number line, and then white bread would land lower on the number line. But within each one, they'd have their own trends. But the idea is that we have subgroups. So if we were interested in fiber content in bread, it might be more interesting to separate by those subgroups. Just graph wheat bread together and see what are the trends within wheat bread and fiber content. In our class, we are mostly going to be focusing on unimodal graphs. So getting a unimodal graph and then describing it as symmetric, skewed left, skewed right. But we want to be careful of these other cases as well. Another thing we want to be careful of are outliers. And outliers look like if we have a graph that has a trend to it, everything's kind of matching up. And then what an outlier does is we have something extreme. An outlier is just an extreme value that comes through, and it just doesn't match up with the rest of our data. It can be that there isn't an extreme result, or maybe the researcher mistyped the number. Something weird's happening with that number. It's not behaving in trend with the other values to the left there. So we want to be careful of outliers because it could be telling us something extreme in our number set that we're looking at. So once we get our graphs, this is how we can start describing them, figure out how many modes we have. If it's unimodal, we can go through describing the shape that we did at the beginning there. And then we just want to be aware of any potential outliers that we see coming through.